Well, good evening, family. God's grace and peace and love and joy and mercy and happiness and wisdom and strength be multiplied in your lives over and over without end in Christ Jesus our Lord. That was the Apostle Paul's desire as you reach the introduction of each of his letters, and that's my desire and prayer for you. This evening, I want to say how much I admire the congregation here more than you know. There's not very many congregations like the congregation here in Olathe. The work that you've done in Bauru and beyond. I mean, what Mel is not doing is not just in Bauru; it's all over the nation. It's touching the nation of Brazil. And the help you sent was sending Mel Jr. to Curitiba years ago and helping us in Curitiba and in Guarapuava. It's amazing. You're helping as a specific missionary do a lot in a lot of different places. And I love to see what you're doing in West Africa and the young family you sent to Cusco, Peru. And I was reading about the church plant in the Christian Chronicle. And this morning I noticed during Bible class your future plans. You're an amazing congregation, and may there be more congregations like this throughout the Brotherhood that's really concerned about loving God and loving one another and loving your neighbor and loving the lost. Tonight, I want to say thank you very much for being our partners in the gospel. I want to thank you for your generous and your sacrificial support for God's work in Brazil. You've not only been helping with our Brazil Work Fund for 7 or 8 years now, and we're doing lots of things for Curitiba even 7 years before that. And the last time I was up here, you gave us a generous contribution to help us with our land, our second land purchase, and the building of Bible classes, and we're very, very thankful. Everything that's said this evening is for God's glory. And just to say, look what God has done. King David wrote something very familiar in Psalms 23. He said, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." In March of this year, my wife and I were in the far northeast of Brazil, in the city of João Pessoa, and I was teaching young Bolivian and Colombian and Brazilian young people to become missionaries. They're in the Adventures in Missions program. It's actually an imitation of the work in Texas, but now it's a Brazilian ministry of Brazilian and Bolivian and Colombian young people that are training and becoming mission teams. Well, I was there in March helping with some of their training, and it was 5:45 a.m. And I was walking on the sidewalk besides the beach in the city of João Pessoa, and it was postcard perfect. The sun was up strong. There's the palm trees, the rolling waves, and the sand, and I was just spending time with my father. And all of a sudden, I was standing in the shadows of the valley of death. I was surrounded by death. The sun was strong, but I was surrounded by the shadows of darkness and death. I saw drunk men stumbling down the sidewalk, accompanied by worldly women, scantily dressed, and prostitutes nearby. They'd all just come out of the all-night bars at 6 a.m. They had spent the entire night in the dark. The drunks didn't even know where they were. They're spiritually dead, they're tripping, they're stumbling, and they're frustrated people. And I thought to myself that very moment, how can I reach these people with the great news of Jesus Christ? The task seems pretty difficult most days, and I feel pretty weak and small. Have you been there and done that? Have you walked in the valley of the shadow of death? Have you seen your friends and your family and your business associates and some of your neighbors frustrated and stumbling and tripping in spiritual darkness? Have you thought to yourself, have you ever, Ellie, just stopped and looked around and said, how can I help them learn about Jesus Christ? Do you feel a little small before the huge task of world evangelism? Here's this question that's bothered me for many, many years. What's the answer? Is there an answer in this modern times? What's the strategy to evangelize the United States, Brazil, and the world in our lifetime, in the short amount of time? We've been working at it, haven't we? All of us here have been working at it. And it seems like the task is so huge. Is there a strategy that will work? Well, God has a very simple and effective strategy. And it's this. Light goes about doing good. That's it. That's it. It's real simple. Let's learn about light. In Job chapter 38, God was asking a series of questions to Job. And one of the questions he asked him was this. Where is the way to the dwelling of the light? No, the source of light's way over there, and the effect of light is seen way over there. God shares in this question that light travels along a path. The fact that light travels, it goes, was discovered by Isaac Newton in the 17th century. Light goes. Light travels. Light literally runs at 186,282 miles per second. That's a pretty awesome way to evangelize the world real quick. But when someone came in here this evening and they flipped on the lights, and from the time that light left the light bulb till it hit the ground, for us it's like instantaneous, but it actually traveled from the light bulb to the ground at 186,000 miles per second. There is nothing in this physical world that travels as fast as light. If you could travel at the speed of light, you could circle the earth 7.5 times in 1 second. That's how fast and effective light is. Light acts. Light goes. Scientists actually have video recorded light. And then they played the film in slow motion and you can see it traveling. Light acts. Light goes. Light goes about doing good. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, the Bible says, God is light. And in him is no darkness. And in the beginning, God saw this world of darkness, and he said, let there be light. And God, who is light, went around doing good and creating beautiful and wonderful things. And one of the things that God created were cherubs. Does some of the young people, do you know what a cherub is? A cherub is an angel, a special angel. Not all angels have wings. These angels have 6 wings, and they're full of light. They're actually like looking at a torch. And you see them in Isaiah 6. They have 2 wings covering their feet and 2 covering their eyes, and with 2 they're flying. And they're over the throne of God going, holy, holy, holy is Lord God Almighty. Well, one of these cherubs decided to leave the light. And you see this taking place according to the account in Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 12. And he is now called the enemy of God, the adversary of God. And this word enemy or adversary is translated from the Hebrew word Satan. And Satan came to this world and he attracted Adam and Eve out of the light into the darkness to disobey God. And they hid behind a tree in the darkness. And from that moment forward, humanity, this world, has been walking and tripping and frustrated, walking blindly in the shadow of death. That's our reality, and we see it every day just looking around us. Sometimes we sort of get tired of looking at it on the TV or seeing our neighbors, and we struggle. I wish we could do something about it. But you know, there's some hope, and here's the hope. In Isaiah chapter 58, verse 8, God prophesied the future. He looked down on humanity, specifically at the tribe of Judah, and he said this. He said, then shall your light, break forth like the dawn. Now, break forth is that moment when the light invades the darkness. When the sun comes up in the morning, running at 186,000 miles per second. Have you seen the sunrise lately? Some of you have seen it. Some of us sleep in from time to time. We miss it. I try to see it most mornings. I live on the third floor of an apartment building, and because there's nobody looking in, I don't have any curtains blocking the view. And so I get up early in the morning and I'm doing exercises and I'm stretching, and all of a sudden, running at 186,000 miles per second, when the sun comes up over that mountain, it illuminates the day and drives the darkness away. How will the spiritual light of God break forth and drive the darkness away? How will the light of God in us invade the darkness and change things? Well, to understand this verse, you actually have to read the previous two verses. And I want you to pay attention to the verbs. Because God's light in us will illuminate the day, the neighborhood, and the world. Pay attention to the verbs. God's light in us breaks forth when someone decides to loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the straps of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, to break every yoke. Well, so far it's not making a whole lot of sense. I mean, what's he talking about? Well, he's going to explain in the next few verses, and he's going to get very personal with us. He says, is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and to bring the homeless poor into your house? And when you see the naked, to cover him, and not to hide yourself from your own flesh, well, then shall your light break forth like the dawn. When you're at the supermarket and you see a shoplifter, and you sort of ignore it, you're just standing in darkness. But if you will be real kind and approach the person and speak up and, well, how are you today? You might ought to put that back on the shelf. You know, there's a lot of cameras and mirrors and don't want you to get in trouble here. And, you know, this is going to make all the prices go up next week for all of us. And how, are you hungry? How about I just buy that for you? Let there be light. Last year, about a year and a half ago in Guarapuava, Brazil, there was a terrible crime. A taxi driver was murdered in the middle of the night. And no one said anything for about a year. Then all of a sudden, someone started, an eyewitness started pointing fingers and accusing people. And five men went to jail. One of them was our brother in Christ in Guarapuava. Well, in Brazil, it's a lot different than the United States. You're not innocent until proven guilty. You are guilty until proven innocent. They locked our brother up for 2 months. And they don't give him anything. Concrete floor, no food. Unless somebody does something about it. So we rounded up a mattress and got some groceries and a toothpaste together and a shave and a kit. And you know what they'll allow. And we helped him and visited him. And I hired a lawyer and I paid for that lawyer. And I began to see the lawyers weren't doing their job. So I went down and gathered up all the police reports and I personally read them all and pointed out to the lawyer all the inconsistency, and there is no eyewitness in this. This is just a false accusation on every count. Then I went before a judge and gave my testimony, and all 5 of those guys got out of jail. Let there be light. Light goes about doing good. Light acts in this world. Light does something to help our fellow human beings in their suffering. Light goes about doing good. Jesus said in John chapter 9, verse 5, he said, I am the light of the world. And for Jesus, light is not just about words on Sunday. Light is action on Monday. One phrase we talk a lot about, and I love it. We're going to Bible study. I love it. And we're here tonight. We're here at Bible study. But tomorrow we're going to Bible practice. We're salt in a salt shaker, and we're going to go out in the community, and we're going to make some things salty. And we're going to illuminate the air by being light. In Acts chapter 10, verse 38, Peter had this task of trying to explain Jesus to the Gentiles. And this is how he did it. In Acts chapter 10, he said, Jesus went about doing good. That's the strategy of world evangelism. Doing good and healing all those who are oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. The light of Jesus invaded the darkness and drove it away when he loved us, and when he served us, and when he fed us, and he clothed us, and he washed our feet, and he died on a cross for us. Jesus was a preacher. And I had this ongoing debate with a sister in Christ in Guadapuava. She says, Alan, you're not supposed to be doing that. You're a preacher, and preachers work with their mind. And I said, Jesus, the preacher, worked with his hands and with his back. So I will carry that concrete, and we are going to mow that lawn. And we're going to love every person we come in contact, because light goes about doing good things. That's what Jesus, the preacher, did. He worked with his mind and with his back and with his hands. Well, Jesus, his light also invaded this world when he trained disciples. And he told these disciples in Matthew chapter 5, 14, he said, you are the light of the world. And Luke chapter 6, he said something that's pretty tough. He said, you need to love your enemies. And you need to do good. And you need to lend money. And don't expect anything in return. And you'll be just like your father. You need to give. And you need to forgive. And the measure that you measure it out with, well, it'll be measured right back to you. Who is Jesus saying we're supposed to love and lend money to? The enemy. Well, why would we do that? Because they're standing in darkness and we are a torch. And by loving with the great lesson this morning, brother, love is this unconditional love is light and action. And you're going to penetrate the darkness. And your enemies, they act that way because no one's ever loved them before. If we will act like God, and it means sacrifice. You know, God feeds 7 billion ungrateful people every single day with the hope that his goodness and kindness, Romans 2, verse 4, will lead them to repentance. And if we will do the same, be like father, like son. We will be like him. So let us forgive, and let's give, and let's help, and let's serve. And I know that you're already doing that here. Keep doing it. Just keep up. Sometimes we get a little tired. Keep it up. Doing the right thing. And the measure we use will be measured back to us, according to Luke chapter 6. I've asked maybe a question for me sometimes. What measuring do I use? Do I use a little spoon or do I use a dump truck? It's going to determine the type of effect we have in this world. Jesus taught his disciples, let your light shine before others. What are you talking about, Jesus? So that they can see your good works and give glory to your Father who's in heaven. Good works means action you've done to help others. Light loves, light acts. Here's an interesting question. Why did God use the action of light to illustrate our task in world evangelism? Light does more than we can imagine. Let's look at just a little of the action of light. Light wakes us up in the morning. Light helps us find a mate. I don't know what you call this bug down here. Yeah, we used to call them fireflies, and some people call them lightning bugs. And fireflies, they emit light to attract a mate. The male, he emits his light. And when the female sees it, well, she emits her light. And that's how they find each other. It's a wonderful way to find a mate. And I love this row of young people down here. If you're looking in the future to have a wonderful Christian wife or a husband, emit spiritual light. And God will bring the most awesome person into your lives. It was 39 years ago. I was at Wyoming Bible Camp. And I showed up there emitting a little bit of light. And there was this beautiful Christian young lady emitting a lot of light. And, well, we've been married for 35 years. Light is awesome. Light tells us, hey, I'm changing lanes. Light says, hey, whoa, back there, I'm stopping. Light is so awesome in traffic that it actually creates harmony amongst the drivers. A lighthouse tells the ships, be careful around the rocks. Lights tell airplanes, don't run over these buildings. Light actually fixes things. When's the last time you welded something? Light can warm you on the beach. Solar-powered energy can actually produce energy in other areas. A light is a signal that you're actually plugged into the energy source, like a cell phone. How are you doing this evening? Are you plugged in every single day to Jesus? Or are you discharged? Light, laser light, concentrated laser light is so powerful. It can cut through steel. It's also so delicate. It can do laser eye surgery and restore vision. Colorful lights, they bring joy around the holidays. Sunlight can guide us through a path. Lightning flashes can tell us that rain is coming. A light can help us read a book at night. Lights on can keep thieves away. Starlight can guide us like a map. Some lamps can heal skin diseases. How about photosynthesis? This is awesome. A plant will take solar energy and convert it into chemical energy to feed itself and store energy for later. Solar light grows plants. Now, this right here is one of the most awesome pieces of technology I've seen in a long time. This is a solar-powered audio player. You don't plug it in. You don't need batteries. You just hold it up to the sun, and it works all the time. And this little audio player is loaded up with the whole Bible, audio.
It's got lessons on there, how to become a Christian, how to grow up as a Christian, how to establish churches. It's got Bible studies on it, just packed with information. And it's being distributed by the church to evangelize those who can't read. Just last year, 2017, the Church of Our Lord distributed 2,000 of these in Africa and 3,000 of these in Asia. Light. Light produces light in others. Light shows the way to God. Light transforms lives. Light drives darkness away. Light is rescuing souls. Light attracts the lost. And light is transforming our world through God's efforts in us. I want to tell you about a four-family evangelistic team of light that formed in Denver, Colorado in 1982. And we trained for about 5 years. And I don't know if you know all the men up there on the screen. Rod Neely from Gillette, Wyoming, and his wife, Linda, and John Serena Langley, he's from the Laramie area. And my wife and I were there in the middle. That's back when I had hair, Jackson Hole, Wyoming. And then we had a family, Ron and Georgia Frey from Taft, California area. A lot of Wyoming boys. One was a Pomida store manager. One was a plumber for the railroad. I was a vacuum cleaner repairman. And the other guy was an oil field worker. And God put these group of guys together and decided to send them to Brazil in 1986. This team of light invaded the darkness in southern Brazil in 1986. This map of South America, you can see the dark blue area, that's Spanish-speaking South America. The light blue area, that's Portuguese-speaking Brazil. And the yellow area in the bottom, that's the state of Paraná. There's actually 27 states in the nation of Brazil. We started in the capital city of Curitiba. Today, it's a city of about 3 million people. We moved there in 1986 and began to share the good news with everyone we met. After 14 years, we built a building there with God's help and help from a lot of people. The local church in Brazil gave $100,000 over a 10-year period, and many churches here in the United States contributed along with us to put this facility together. And it sets up to 1,000 people. The church grew to 360 members by the 2011, and at the year 2011, we had worked ourselves out of a job. In 2011, we turned the work completely over to three Brazilian elders, three evangelists, two supported by the local work, and six deacons. It's a totally autonomous and self-sustaining congregation. By using a preacher training school in Curitiba for about 5 years and graduating three classes, light invaded one of the neighborhoods in Curitiba. Curitiba is a city of 3 million people. This is the Sítio Cercado neighborhood, and it has a population of 200,000 people. We rented a facility, and soon after we had three or four small groups going, and there's about 50 people that live in that area. And one thing that's so awesome about this work, they're now in the process. They've actually purchased land in the neighborhood, and they're going to be beginning a building program in the near future. And how are they paying for this land? The downtown congregation in Curitiba. All the members got together and loaned them the money, and they're paying the members back. They didn't even borrow it from the bank. It's amazing what they're doing. Well, in 2010, we're just a year from working ourselves out of a job, and light invaded the city of Guarapuava. Let me just, hopefully I'll remember some of these names, but let me give you a few definitions. Curitiba, that's the capital city. It means a group of pine trees. It's an Indian word. Curitiba is a group of pine trees. And in Sítio Cercado, that's a Portuguese term for a surrounded farm. And Guarapuava is an Indian term. It means a courageous wolf. Guara is a wolf, and Puava is a courageous wolf. So I live in Courageous Wolf. But we started visiting this town in the very heart of the state about 8 years ago. My wife and I were still living in Curitiba, helping with the team, putting the final touches on the eldership there. And we decided to go to the interior. This city has about 200,000 people. It's in the very center of the state. I can drive from this city to any city in the state between 3 to 5 hour drive. It's very strategically located. One thing that's, I'll give you something just to compare it with. Our state of Paraná is about the size of the state of Kansas. Kansas has a population of 2,900,000 people. That's a lot of folks right here in Kansas that you're trying to evangelize. Keep it up. 2,900,000. Well, we live in a state roughly the same size as Kansas, and we have 11 million, four times the population, in 399 cities and towns. We have churches in nine cities, and I have 390 to go. Some people say, when are you coming home? I don't know, but we're going to keep going as long as God gives me energy. There's a lot of work to be done. But this is an awesome little city, and we began to visit it every 40 days. We'd go every 40 days just for a weekend, and I would teach the Bible for about 10 hours over the weekend, and I'd say, see you later, for about 40 days later. During this four-year process, 13 people were baptized into Christ, were meeting in homes, and evangelizing and edifying these converts. Well, my wife and I decided to move to Guadapuava, and while we're packing our bags and getting ready to move, someone invited us to visit another city. It's called the city of São Mateus do Sul, St. Matthew of the South. It's about a two-hour drive from Curitiba, about a four-hour drive from Guadapuava. So as I'm trying to move to Guadapuava, we're also visiting this little town. It's a town of 40,000 people. There was no church there. And we began going there, I guess during 10 months, we went there almost every week, with exception maybe two weekends, for 10 months straight. We would finish worship in Guadapuava. And Bible class, we'd get in the car, drive for 4 hours, and we'd have worship and class and evangelize, and then we'd get in the car and drive 4 hours home. It was 8 hours in the car every Sunday just to get to this little place. But there were several people baptized. A little building was built there. And we've taken several groups from Guadapuava to encourage them. And then when my body got tired sitting in the car for that 10 months, I took a break, and the Curitiba took over, and they started sending groups of people every week to help this congregation. I was just there a couple of months ago, and whenever I go, I end up leading singing, and I preach for them, and I try to do what Marshall Keeble used to do. When I preach in this little town, I bring those young men up beside me, and I preach, and they read the scriptures, and hopefully we're going to turn out some little preachers from this little group of people. Well, we finally got to move. After 4 years on the road visiting Guadapuava, we moved to Guadapuava in 2014 after 27 years in Curitiba. We're just getting started there. We were meeting in a home. We weren't fitting in the home anymore, so we just temporarily get by. We say in Portuguese, dar um jeito quebra galho. We're going to get by. We rented a little house in the outskirts of town, and it filled up real fast, and we got to looking around for some land. And I didn't want to spend a dime on rent because I know after a few years, about 7 or 8 years, you would have paid for the place. So instead of paying rent, I went right after a location to purchase. My wife and I sold our house. We took a chunk of change and we put a down payment on that thing. And other brothers and sisters helped us pay it off within the year. We have this little building. It's in the downtown area on near the main avenue of the city. It sits 100 people and has one Bible class inside. And we've been using it for the past few years. On the back side of our building, you see our building on the left, the brick building. On the back side, there was a lot for sale right on the main avenue, the main avenue of the city, a four-laner, runs the length of the city. And when I was up here last time, we're all sweating and sacrificing. You were too, and I'm thankful for your generosity last time I was here, because this was going to be a long process, and it ended up, the land was totally paid for within the year. Well, several members of the church, along with the Guadapuava church, sacrificing monthly, we started construction. We bought the land so we'd have some Bible classes. We only had one Bible class and a bunch of children. So we began cleaning the land. We had a groundbreaking ceremony in 2016. We got the project approved. We have the oldest member of the church and the youngest participating in the groundbreaking ceremony. And this is a view of it. There's our building on the left, and this is the lot right behind it that's on the main avenue. We began the foundation. This is our brother in Christ. He's a good preacher and evangelist, but he's our master of works. And hand dug the foundation. We have two Bible classes on the bottom and two bathrooms in the middle. And right there in the front is the entry to the back of our building, which is going to be the brand new entrance on the main avenue. This is our foundation. We hand poured it with wheelbarrows. And the walls began going up between August and October 2017. And by October 2017, we had to stop. Our master of our building, our chief builder, I can't remember how you say these guys' names in English. He's had a heart defect since birth, and he's about 47 years old. And it got to a point, the doctor said, you've got to do it. I mean, he was working, and he just passed out and fall out of his pickup. So they rushed him over to the hospital and did open heart surgery on our brother, and our construction stopped. And we didn't know how long it was going to stop. maybe for a month or two. Well, it poured rain for 3 months. What a blessing. So while he's healing up and it's pouring rain, we couldn't do anything anyway. But in January, we began building again, putting the second floor on. It's a concrete floor that we're putting on there. Where our brother's there by the window. That whole wall is being taken out right now, and that's going to be the entrance into the upstairs Bible classes from our first building. Yeah. We took a big old hose and hooked up to a concrete truck, and one held the hose and the other one spread it out. And so construction's a little different. This is our brother in Christ, our chief master builder. I wish he was on my football team. This is 3 months after having open heart surgery, and he catches those bricks all day with bare hands. I mean, we could have made some touchdowns way back then. This is our second floor of our building. We got the roof on, and this is what it looked like. And this is what your contributions have helped to accomplish over the last couple of years, and your special contributions when we were here. This is where it was at a month ago. This is what it looks like today. The windows are already going in. The doors are going in. We're putting down the tile like you have here in the middle aisle. That's going to be all over the floor upstairs and downstairs. And hopefully by the end of September, we're going to be moving in and have our occupancy permits. This is our location. You can see that red sign on the left. That's our first building, and this is the four-laner, which we're actually located on now as we open the doors. What an awesome place. Everybody in town knows where the Church of Christ is. This is the church in Guadapuava right now. We have 43 faithful and active members, and we have 13 small children. We have about 56 people. Our attendance is about 50 every Sunday. We have some special days from time to time. This is one of our special days in February. We had 100 in attendance. Whew, and we can't hold anymore. So if we keep doing special days, we're going to invite you. We're going to do some double services until we figure out our next step. We have our potlucks right in the auditorium. That may be strange. We just use the space we do. We move all of our chairs out of the way and set up white tables and have potluck. Back in November and December, my wife and I, we made a trip up to a preacher training school along the highway that runs the length of the state. And then we made that trip again in December. And we stopped in each city and we prayed for God to help us start a new congregation in every city on the interstate. In January, God started a new congregation. We didn't know where to start. And it's a cool story how this congregation began. And maybe I can share with you during the stick around. But this new congregation just started in January in the city of Cantagallo. It means rooster crows. And we meet in their home every Sunday afternoon. So we have worship and Bible class a Sunday morning. And then a group from Guadapuava goes there every Sunday. And they've already been there this afternoon and had a worship service. And they get home about 7 o'clock in the evening. Our major evangelistic outreach in Guadapuava is either through a biblical theology class where we hand out thousands of invitations and we invite people to just come study the Bible with me for 3 hours every Tuesday night for 3 months. And we had 40 denominational leaders and their wives show up from February till May. And so several of them have become Christians. Several of them are just attending worship because they're leaving their denomination. It's amazing what God is doing. I've been praying Jesus' prayer for God to raise up workers. And he is. Most of our converts instantly are already evangelizing others. And this is some certificates I handed out to the class when it closed out in May. We also use small group evangelism in several homes. We usually have 5 groups. We have 3 at the present. And the result, it says 36 up there. We've actually had 33 baptisms in the last 2 years. We've had 18 in the last 5 months. And the reason I put 36 up there is because there's 3 that are supposed to be baptized this afternoon in Cantagallo, the new church plant that started in January. There's so many stories. The lady in the upper left hand, she's blind. She's frail. But someone shared the light with her. And she rarely gets to worship, but we take the Lord's Supper to her house every week. My wife was teaching a young lady how to embroider, and before you know it, they're talking about the gospel, and she was born again. This young couple, they were living together, 2 small children, and my wife and I worked with them in their home until they were married, and they were baptized, and they're a beautiful young family. These 2 men were coming to my theology class, they're denominational leaders, and they're going home and teaching their wives, and then my wife and I started having them over for dinner and doing marriage enrichment classes, and all 4 were baptized about 11:30 one evening. This is the young couple that's baptized in a new church plant, just about an hour drive from us in Cantagallo. This young man has the green towel around his shoulder. There's so much to say. I scooped him off the street. He doesn't have a dad. His mom works all day, goes to school at night. He's just been abandoned. It's either the drug traffickers or me. So I scooped him off the street at 14, played ball with him, taught him games, took him to youth retreats, evangelized him, baptized him. I challenged him 2.5 years ago to memorize 12 Bible verses a month. He is a walking Bible. He's 18, phenomenal young preacher. He's finishing his last year of high school, leads a small group for teenagers. He's baptized a number of his friends. Last month, he taught Bible class every Sunday morning. He's preaching a 6-lesson series this month on Sunday mornings. I taught him to speak English. He self-taught. He's already reading Greek. And I am fired up about this young man. He's my son in the faith. There's a family winning family. This is great. I'll tell you real briefly. The young, beautiful woman here in the middle, this is Jennifer. I taught her the gospel when she was 13. When she was 17, she began dating the man in the red shirt. Her father taught him the gospel. He became a Christian. And over a 3-year period, they taught his little brother. Then they taught his parents. I did their wedding ceremony in May. This is DeMarco's, one of his granddaughters. Mel Torres knew her grandfather in the 70s and actually trained him. This young couple I married did their wedding ceremony in May. They moved to the preacher training school in June, fully supported by the Guadalupe Church. They'll be there for 2 years, and they're coming back in 2 years to help me as we're building a Brazilian mission team in Guadalupe. Oh, there's so many stories. This is a Pentecostal leader just baptized just a couple weeks before I come up here. He's already evangelizing and has a small group in his home. This is the last two people I saw baptized before I got on the airplane coming up here. This is great. This is a young man that came to our theology class, and then he began bringing his father and mother-in-law to the theology class. They completed it, and then this son-in-law baptized his mother-in-law into Christ, and I told him not to hold her under too long, but they're a beautiful Christian family. We've been busy about having lots of weddings. We've had several weddings, so many stories. This is my son in the faith, my Timothy, great young man. We've been teaching these young men. This is him preaching at Curitiba this year. This is a young man that he taught the gospel to, João Gabriel. He taught him 3-minute Bible studies between classes at high school. Biology, 3 minutes of Bible. Math, 3 minutes. History, 3 minutes. Physical education. He did this for 3 weeks till I baptized him. He's a young man that is highly persecuted by his family, but he is a good young preacher. He's teaching Bible class every Sunday morning to the adults, 17 years old. We began bringing Bolivians and Brazilians from the north down to work as AIM teams. And they train for 8 months. They're 18 to 20 years old. And then they come to these small congregations like ours and help us for 14 months. We've had two teams. This is the team that's on the field with us right now. They'll be finishing up next March. And boy, they've helped us start Vacation Bible School. This was last year. This is Vacation Bible School just last month. They helped us have 2 children's Bible classes. They have Mother's and Father's Day breakfasts. And speaking of that, Feliz Dia dos Pais, Año, Mel. Today is Father's Day in Brazil. And they had a breakfast just like that before worship this morning. We had our first women's conference. These AIM teams have helped us have our first women's conference. In February, we had 70 women from 3 or 4 congregations around the state, and we had several visitors from the community. My wife's been taking the light to several cities. She speaks in women's conferences around the nation. This is her in Campo Grande. It's a capital city. She was speaking in São Paulo last year. This is Curitiba last year. I teach, besides our work in Guadalupe, I also teach at 2 preacher training schools in the nation where we teach. I can only go there for a week, and I do a lot what NU does. We go there for a week, and we give them, 25 to 30 hours of Bible teaching in 4 to 5 days. It's like preaching 50 times in 4 days, isn't it, Mel? Man, whew, it's a workout. We've been helping the poor. The Guadalupe Church has built these 2 houses. 4 years ago, we built the one in blue for a family, and just a month ago, we finished this one. People just sacrificing, trying to help the poor have a place to live. More light is coming to Guadalupe. This young family is going to move there in January as we're building a Brazilian team. I've got to get more workers, and so they're moving there in January, partially supported by the Guadalupe Church and partially supported by friends and family here in the United States. This young family are Guadalupe converts. They're supported by the Guadalupe Church. They're in preacher training school. They'll be back in 2020 to work full time. These 2 young men, these are our goals for next March. These 2 young men, Atahualpa and João Gabriel, we want to send them to the Brazilian AIM program in March, supported by the Guadalupe Church. And then we want to send them to preacher training school after their 2-year experience there and form their own mission team. These are awesome young men, and you
are a part of it. This is my challenge for you tonight. Light goes about doing good. Do good for someone this week. Just go out of your way and do it. Go about seeking to do good for someone who can't do it for themselves. Do good for someone without charging for your services. Sacrifice something from your life with unconditional love, as we talked about this morning, and light will break forth all around you. Let there be light. Can you imagine what will happen if every single one of us will accept this challenge tonight? It's not words. That's just not words on Sunday. It's action on Monday. What will happen? Our friends, our neighbors, our business associates, it's not instantaneous, but we're going to make progress, and they're going to become Christians. And your light, your life of light, is going to motivate and transform others, and their lights can start, and other lights are going to start. New Testament congregations, new congregations are going to be established. They're going to be motivated. Old congregations are going to be renewed. The world will be reached for Christ in our lifetime because light is fast. This is the strategy. It's light. And God will be glorified when he sees your and my good works. Light goes about doing good. Let there be light. We're going to sing right now. And as always, sometimes we have some special needs going on here and we need to pray. Let's pray tonight. One of the elders, Richard, will come up and pray with you. Maybe you've been thinking about the death, burial, and resurrection and you're not in the light. You're still over here in the darkness and it's time to get in the light. You can do it tonight. You can do it during the song. You can do it after worship. You can do it this week. But if you need some attention, let it be known to your brothers and your family here. Let's sing.